Okay, so my last video on this topic was really, really long. It was like 10 minutes 56 seconds. So this might feel really extraneous. But I realized the more I thought about this topic, actually I left a lot of stuff that I could talk about. I don't know if I actually remember them in this video, but I hope I do. So, I don't really care if BLACKBOND doesn't watch this. If you don't watch it, that's fine. You can have your keep your opinion on Japanese RPGs not evolving, having been stagnant, needing to change, needing to evolve. But I did think quite a number of things, and the one thing that I really forgot to mention that I really wanted to bring out is that I think with Japanese RPGs, the main deal is with the subtle differences. And I mentioned this like way back when I was reviewing Golden Sun, and I think to Japanese RPGs, the gameplay really changes when there's a subtle difference. And for this video, I'm not going to use Golden Sun as an example. I'm actually going to use Disgaea as an example. Disgaea 1, 2, and 3, they all seem like they use the same exact mechanics. They all seem like the franchise hasn't evolved at all. It still uses turn-based mechanics. It still has the item world. It still has the overworld map system where it still has that. It still has the level creation character system thingy, the dark assembly. It still has all that, right? Everything seems the same. But I compare every single one of those three games, and there's subtle differences among those games that really change the experience. At least to me, it did. I mean, for one, the changes made in Disgaea 2 made me not like Disgaea 2 that much. I really didn't have that much fun with Disgaea 2. There are a lot of more frustrating experiences in it. It changed. Disgaea 3, I think, is amazing. Like these little tiny subtle differences, I think, really changes everything. At least to me, it does. For example, the one thing that Disgaea 2 and 3 introduced was the monster chain combo, right? So now you can actually chain transform the monsters into an item or weapon, and you get to utilize special combo, or special move with the monster as a weapon. And each different monster type can be turned into a different type of weapon. So that's one change that really made the monster class more usable, because in Disgaea 1, monsters are worthless. They can't lift. The only thing they're good for is being tanks. Their HP is extremely high, their defense is extremely high, and if you equip them with the right claw, the right monster weapon, their attack is really high. That was really it. Otherwise, you would rather use a demon character, an angel character, or Celestia character, or a human character, because they're so much better. Also, another thing that really changed with Disgaea 2, at least these are the positive aspects of Disgaea 2 that really changed, was the experience system and how it changed. Now you get experience points for healing, for magic kills, for using magic. So for different amount of magic you use, you really get different experiences, which adds more nuance to character creation and to character evolution and the character progression as well. And there's also different kind of character classes that were introduced, but that's not really an evolution of gameplay mechanic, that's just adding on more features. Disgaea 3 really changed the gameplay mechanics, kind of subtly, but in a very different way, by evolving the mana system into points that you can use. And so that when you kill something, you're not only getting experience points, but you're also getting mana points. So that mana points you can actually use to create new characters, to buy moves. So you don't even have to level up to actually gain certain moves anymore, but you can buy moves. You can also buy upgrade those moves, especially magic moves, so you can have more grid attack, more area effect damage. And this all plays into the dark assembly, which is no longer dark assembly in Disgaea 3, but sort of a classroom kind of a class. The way it's boded, the way dark assembly works has also changed. Whereas in Disgaea 1 and 2 both use the same dark assembly system, where it's the amount of boats that determines. But in Disgaea 3, it's more the percentage. It's not more the boats, but they have this kind of percentage system where the green light is approved, red light is not approved. It's totally different, totally new, kind of evolved way for the better, I think. Also, they included new new ways, new items in the dark assembly or the dark classroom, I guess. The creature creation has kind of changed so that in a way, the where the creature characters are placed in the classroom setting affects their alliance on their team attacks. You know, that's something totally new. Magic chains are new. There's so many different subtleties. It's even with the geo blocks. You know, in Disgaea 1 and 2, you know, there's just the triangular geometric blocks that affects the area map, right? In Disgaea 3, they're no longer the triangle, I forgot what they're called, geo blocks, whatever. But now they're just this rectangular thingy. And when you throw them and you chain them, chaining is not just about destroying the geo blocks, but chaining is also has been evolved, progress into matching them into the right colors or matching them into different kind of colors, and stacking them up or throwing them and lifting has changed. When you lift, tower attacks have kind of evolved into something more. So you can see all these little subtle differences have actually made Disgaea 3 into a totally different playing experience, into a more evolved experience. So you may look at different kinds of Japanese games and you're like, oh, it feels the same, it's the same. And to a regular onlooker, I mean to an average onlooker, yeah, it basically is the same system. But it's the nuanced, subtle differences that actually really change everything. With Japanese RPGs, it's not just about the main selling features. It's about the whole playing experience as a whole. You look at something like Dragon Quest as a franchise. You know, a lot of people say that you play one Dragon Quest game, you play them all. Maybe that's true because, I mean, the mechanics are pretty much very similar, but there are subtle nuances in there that really change the playing experience. You know, the way you level up is kind of changed, especially in all Dragon Quest games. And Dragon Quest 8, you introduce psych-up feature. The psych-up feature really changed. Oh, maybe not Dragon Quest 8, but Dragon Quest 6, I believe, introduced the psych-up feature. So it introduced a new element of strategy to the gameplay, and also to the skill system that Dragon Quest 8 kind of introduced. And Dragon Quest 8 games in particular, down to 9, have not been linear. At least you can not linear in the sense that like Final Fantasy 13 is going to be, or Final Fantasy 10 was, or that what other? I think that's pretty much the linear Final Fantasy games go, but not in that sense. But you have an overworld to explore, to do anything that you want to do. You know, there's so in a way there is a lot of evolution and progression and differences in the genre. It's just that they're all often very, very subtle. You know, and I think in this genre, subtleties matter a lot. You know, in many other genres, maybe subtleties don't matter as much. You know, Fallout New Vegas, I guess they can add a little subtleties here and there, but I don't see it really changing that much. Mass Effect 1 and 2, there are a lot of differences, especially because Mass Effect 2 abandons the inventory mechanic, you know, managing system, so it's more of a shooting game than an RPG. I don't really know how that's more of an evolution than just downgrading, but it does make it more action-packed, so it makes it more exciting, more appealing to Western gamers who are into shooters. It becomes more of a shooter than an RPG, so I don't really get where the innovation is in Mass Effect 2, other than the technological aspects of improved graphics, improved loading times, improved frame rate, improved storytelling, more focused storytelling, not improved storytelling, you know. Where you know, I mean, compare the evolution of Western RPGs and compare the evolution of JRPGs as a whole. Compare the two. There isn't that big of a gap, in my opinion. You know, I mean, you mentioned, I guess, the whole you I think I read some of your comments saying that White Knight Chronicles is total crap, and you playing the game will only make you feel like, you know, that it was crap to begin with, and that you're going to affirm that the genre has become stale and needs to evolve. I read that comment and I was just like, really? White Knight Chronicles? White Knight Chronicles introduces different kind of online play. It has total online side quests. It has online customization. I mean, for a Japanese genre, that's not very common in the Japanese RPG genre. What do you expect? And the White Knight Chronicles in particular is not the same cookie cutter turn-based system that we're all used to. It's really different. It's kind of like active time turn-based system, but in a way it has more to do with, I haven't actually played the game myself, but I know how it functions, and it's not like any other JRPG. So it changed. It's different than the JRPGs. It's kind of evolved. Maybe a lot of, you know, Western reviewers didn't like it. A lot of Japanese reviewers didn't like it either. I mean, Famitsu didn't give it that high of a score. You know, but I mean, who's counting scores? I never count scores. I actually count the content of the review or the actual playing experience. You know, and in that regard, White Knight Chronicles does a lot of different things, and level 5 never sticks with one system. You know, you can always tell that Dark Cloud, White Knight Chronicles, Rogue Galaxy, Dragon Quest VIII. Look at all those different systems. All those games, they all utilize different systems. So how can you criticize them for not evolving, for not changing, when they in fact just look at one developer, level 5, their history has always changed. Their mechanics have always changed, whether subtly or just totally completely. So, you know, I understand your frustration of not liking a genre that you once liked, but criticizing that entire genre as being stagnant and stale when you have different games that try different things, that introduce different things, that change, that evolve, I don't really see where your criticism is coming from.